It's 7 o'clock if you could find a seat. It's actually a few minutes after. See, we have a state representative just came in. If you can find a seat, I think we have enough. I know we have enough chairs. Our pastor seems not to be here.
He is not. His wife is having cardiac cath in the morning, so they're out.
Ah, okay. Well, we always open the meeting with a prayer and a pledge, so
go ahead, do it.
I will do both in that case. So if you would, bow with me for prayer really quickly. Lord, thank you for this day, another day we get to come and enjoy the beautiful fall. What a wonderful time of year. We thank you for the opportunity to gather together still in this country to pray to you, to address you, and to talk about the issues of the day, to talk about politics, to hold our politicians accountable, to pray for them and lift them up. So we do that now. All of our elected representatives, all the way down to the local level, we pray that you would give them wisdom, that they would restrain evil and reward those who do good. So bless this time together and use us to help others to be more involved and bring revival in this nation. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand with me for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the
flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. My name is David Hancock. This is the United Tea Party of Georgia. If you want to be somewhere else and are here by happy coincidence, we're glad. We hope you stay. We have a raffle we're going to do right now. We're going to give away...
Does everybody have a ticket? If you don't, please let us know.
We've got a... I see somebody I know. No, I just saw somebody I know who's not usually over here. This is a book that I... that the United Tea Party does not endorse, but it's an interesting idea, and you would learn a bit about Constitution and some other stuff. It's a move to get rid of the Electoral College. Whether you like it or dislike it, it's in the Constitution, and this is an end run around the Constitution to make that happen. So we're going to give this away. It's a lot of, oh no, they're all over the floor. It's a lot of words to say that.
No, it's fine. That was three of them. You get to share.
Okay. Oh, I have to read it. Looks like the last three numbers probably going to be enough. Is 415?
415.
Okay, so you have to read this by next month and give us a report. Also, one of the things that we want to make sure everybody has is, unlike some of the legislation that's passed today, the Declaration and the Constitution can all fit here, along with commentary and a cover front and back. So if anybody is lacking a constitution and would like to have one, they're free. We would love to give you one. Anybody? Yes? Yeah, here. Okay, good. Oh, yes, ma'am. I like you in the book, too. Who's here? It looks like we have some people here for the first time, right? Oh, that's fantastic. Thank you so much for coming. I've got something else. I hope.
We need another one.
Oh, we need another one. Here we go. We've also got someone videotaping. Nydia Tisdale is here, and she has these little handbooks. These are put out by the Secretary of State's office, and they're everything you need to know and more about open records laws in Georgia. So, if you can find out a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff that they don't even intend for you to find out just by asking. So there's ways to ask and ways to ask correctly. So these, I would encourage you to grab one. They're fantastic. They'll be right up here on the table at the end. Let's go ahead and get started because I imagine we'll have some questions at the end. Our speaker tonight is Todd Rehm. He's been reading his newsletter for a number of years. A long time it seems. If you don't get it, I'm sure he will have a website up. I should go ahead and turn this on. Pretty soon it will show you where you can get it. It's fantastic. It comes out in the morning. It's the first thing he does, and it's national, but everything local, everything you'd want to know about politics in Georgia. And it's easy to read. You can skim through it and get the parts that interest you. So I think he's got a slide that introduces himself. So I will let that get things started and turn it over to Todd. Ready?
There we go. Is there a way to turn the brightness
up? It gets brighter as it warms up.
My name is Todd Rehm. It's pronounced like the air conditioning company, though I get no royalties from them. This is just about every conceivable way to get in touch with me. GeorgiaPundit.com is my website. Every morning, I write the day's news, taking liberally from other people. And then I also send out an email. If you go to the website, there are a couple places where you can sign up for the email. It comes out between 7 and 9 most mornings. Unless I'm really tired, then it comes out at 10. What I do is three things. I try to give you enough of a survey of the political news of the state of Georgia that you could go somewhere and have a reasonably intelligent conversation with an elected official, with a fellow activist at a meeting like this, and know what's going on without having to spend your time going to every single website that I waste all day looking at. The second thing I try to do is give a little behind the scenes look at politics, both from the sausage making factory of actually making things happen in government and on the politics side. I am a professional political consultant. I run campaigns for a living. I've never held an honest job. And sometimes during the legislature, I spend a lot of time down there. Sometimes I will advise clients who get elected to different offices, not what they ought to be doing, but how to communicate that with people. And I like to say that I never tell anyone what they ought to think. I tell them how to better communicate what they think to other people. Because when you spend a lot of time trying to become an expert in something, a lot of times you assume somebody else has knowledge of the basics you're talking about. And for most elected officials, when they become engrossed in an issue, they talk to you as though you understand the basics. And I try to reel them back and help them understand that if you're going to use an acronym, you need to define what it means the first time. Things that come from just having a little bit of distance. The third thing I try to do is to have a way for talking about what the news media does right and what they do wrong. I think that the Atlanta Journal-Constitution does a fantastic job of finding out facts and writing about facts. What I don't think they always do a great job of, and most newspapers are like this, they're good at figuring out what time the meeting was on Wednesday night. It's when they take three different facts and they impose a narrative on them and try to tell you what happened or what it means. That's where bias creeps in. And sometimes you can take those same three facts and fit two or three different stories about it. The Atlanta Journal-Constitution or your local newspaper may have their version of what those facts mean. I think you're probably intelligent enough if you can read to figure out what those facts mean yourself. And sometimes what that means is, well, let's have an experiment in what these three things could mean that are different from what the dominant media narrative is. And I try to treat people like they're adults. You have to write for an eighth grade level or a sixth grade level. That means writing clearly, but it doesn't mean treating people like they're stupid. And then there's a fourth thing that I do, and that's I talk a lot about dogs. The first day I started publishing my morning news, I put a couple dogs from the rescue group that my wife and I had adopted from, because I thought it would be a nice way to share what's available out there, what you can do. And I assumed that people would eventually complain about the dogs and say, we're here for the politics, get the dogs away. Dogs are the most popular part. And so I bow to the wisdom of the marketplace. And if the marketplace demands dogs every day, I provide them. These two are little puppies. They look to me like they're probably not even 8 weeks old. They're available from your local Forsyth County Animal Shelter. One of the reasons I talk about dogs is I love them. The other is, this is government at work. There is a good chance, I don't know what the chances are in this county, but in the state of Georgia, there's a good chance that, particularly in Northwest Georgia, that puppies like this get killed with our tax dollars. And I just think there's a better way. And so I like to talk about not just the dogs, but what we can do as people to help them at a cost savings to taxpayers. But step number one is, one of y'all go out and get these two puppies tomorrow. In the last year, I've talked a lot publicly about polling. It's something that I've done in campaigns for about 15 years. I've probably done close to as many polls in the state of Georgia as anybody else here. But for years, it was black magic. You sort of call a bunch of people, churn out a bunch of numbers, and tell people what they mean. In the last 2 or 3 years, we've had a lot more discussion of how do you get to these results. And so not only do I do my own work, but I also talk to, when Governor Deal's campaign said that their pollster did a great job and had everything right, I called him up and said, hey, what did you do differently? And this is part of the behind the scenes mission. When people are interested in polling, and those of us who are interested in politics talk about polling like it's the daily box scores. And I think it behooves us to know a little bit more. We don't all have to be able to do a poll, but understanding how to be good consumers of it keeps us from relying on other people to tell us what it means and which polls are good, which polls are bad, and what they mean. One of the great things about talking about polling is occasionally I get to be on TV to talk about it. What I want you to understand is when you see somebody talking about a poll on TV, they were paid by the TV station, not by one of the candidates, not by one of the campaigns. They may have some expertise, but they're not there as experts so much as they are as entertainers. And that is one thing I want you to remember. Every time you see the poll numbers flip-flop, and oh my gosh, I thought my candidate was in first place, and now he's 7 points behind. That may not be true. That may just be the entertainment aspect of it. Because TV's sometimes wrong. Last year, there was a lot of discussion going into the both the primaries and into the general election that Georgia was on the verge of becoming a purple state. How many of y'all thought we were going to have a runoff in December of 2014? I did. I absolutely thought we were headed that way because everybody told me we were. Afterwards, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution kind of had their tail between their legs, and they wrote a story that said, there was one thing most polls seemed to agree on. The top two races in Georgia were so close that both might have to be decided by runoffs. And then Kerwin Swint, a professor over at Kennesaw, said, we have major polling problems in Georgia. Do most of y'all agree or disagree with that?
I agree.
Raise your hands if you agree. Disagree? Okay, everybody who raised their hand agreed. So let's see. This is a 2010 general election between Rory Barnes and Nathan Deal. I don't remember anybody saying we had a huge problem with polling in 2010. And this is Real Clear Politics. Does anyone follow Real Clear Politics? It's realclearpolitics.com. They combine all of the publicly released polls. And the one thing they do that I really like is they have what's called the RCP average. It's this line right here. And it's a rolling average of all the polls that have been released. And I tend to think that average takes, it de-emphasizes the bad pollsters and mixes them in with a bunch of good polls, and it's generally pretty good. At the end of the 2010 general election, the RCP average, that gray line, had Deal up 7.5%. And if you recall, I think we were all pretty confident heading into that election that Nathan Deal was going to win. And he did, in fact, win by 9.8 points. The difference between 7.5 and 9.8 is 2.3 points. What's a typical margin of error for a poll? 2.5, 3.5, 5 points, somewhere in that range. That's about the sample size. So that's within most margins of error, right? 2.3 points. So that's pretty good. Then we had 2014. The final results, Nathan Deal won by 8 points. The average was 4.6 points. So 3.4 point difference. That's within most margins of error. You don't often see a margin of error lower than 3.5. And if you look at the last week, this is 2 points off, this is 4 points off, 3 points off. That's not so bad. That's not disastrous. Most of these had Governor Deal pretty close to 50%, and that undecided, generally speaking, will break a little bit in favor of the incumbent. So was the polling really that bad in 2014? One polling group stands out as having been pretty bad, and that was the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. So when they're saying all of the polling was wrong, what they really mean is our polling was really wrong, and we want to spread the blame. And if you look over the course of the campaign, this right-hand column shows Governor Deal winning probably 90% of the time, and it's a pretty steady race. It was not the Michelle Nunn, Jason Carter was up and then Deal was up. It wasn't switching back and forth like that. It was pretty steady. But what is the bias that reporters have? A lot of people would say that they're liberals, and a lot of them are. I think the other bias they have that is more important, because it's uniform to all writers, is they want to make what they're interested in interesting to you. And what do they think you're interested in? Conflict, changes, a horse race that changes leader every few minutes. If they had said in the beginning of 2014, the election's going to be just like 2010, don't you worry about it. Just go vote when you have to, and it's going to come out pretty much the same. They would have been more accurate than they were. But that's not a good story. Somebody who has devoted his life to writing about how exciting politics is in Georgia would have a tough time over the last 10 years. What can you write at the beginning of almost any contested election? Republican's going to win. Republican's going to win. Maybe a different kind of Republican sometimes, but a Republican's going to win. And this is how campaigns work. This is how public polling, this is how polling really works. These are close to the actual numbers going over the course of the campaign, starting out in early 2014 and ending on election day. Two important things I want to talk about. The first is called partisan identification. It's whether somebody, when they're called up and asked, are you a Democrat, a Republican, or something else, it's what they answer. Some will say Republican, some will say Democrat. Some will say something different than they said 2 weeks ago because they just saw a great story about somebody of the other party and decide, well, maybe I'm a Democrat or maybe I'm a Republican. But it doesn't change overnight. What happens is you start out in January, February, March, whatever, with some proportion of the electorate saying, I'm a Democrat, in my heart of hearts, I'm going to vote for the Democrat. And some percentage says, I'm going to vote for the Republican. They're pretty close in Georgia. Maybe 33 to 34% consider themselves a Democrat inside here. Maybe 36, 38% consider themselves a Republican. But that changes. We don't have party registration. So the only measure of whether you're a Republican or whether you're a Democrat is what you wake up thinking you are that morning. And so that's going to change over time. Over the course of 2014, Republicans became more popular as we learn more and more about what a failure Democratic policies are, and Democrats became less popular. Does everybody kind of think that's about accurate? And then the dark blue and dark red lines show you where the candidate was. When Jason Carter first announced, people asked who they would vote for. Fewer of them said they would vote for Jason Carter than said they were Democrats. What that means is he's a new person, he's got a great name, I like his name if I'm a Democrat, but I need to learn a little bit more about him before I decide whether I'm going to vote for him. But at some point, probably August, September, his support as Jason Carter grew greater than the people who simply said, I'll vote for the Democrat. Governor Deal, as an incumbent frequently will, starts out with a personal popularity level higher than that of his party. If you recall, last year, seemed like all year long, it was a constant barrage of job announcements, new jobs here, new jobs there, a lot of good press for him. So he started out higher than the party, and he built on it steadily. And the trajectory of those lines didn't change much. It was a pretty boring election, in the matter of fact. But that doesn't sell newspapers. It doesn't get you clicks on your website. What you want to do is you want to have the poll that says, we thought somebody was going to win it last week, and now we think something differently. Everything's in chaos, because that's what makes people want to read your stuff or watch it on television. Did you have a question, sir?
I did, on this graph.
Yes, sir.
If you look at the start and times, the Democrats dropped, what, about 3%, 5%?
Yes, sir.
And the Republicans gained about, 5 to 10%
over
that time frame?
Yeah, probably.
Whatever the numbers are, just guessing. If you're looking to target a group of voters, then that's a very small percentage that's going to swing one way or another.
Yeah.
You're only talking maybe 10% at the most.
Except that part of what you're going to be doing is during this period, you're going to try to be dragging down not just the other candidate, but their party. You want to make sure that the other party's number is slanted downward. And so that's part of what you're doing.
Yeah, but the point is that it's a very small percentage that you can actually swing one way or another.
And I'm going to suggest, and we'll go into this in a couple slides, that undecideds, there are very few of them. That's not where we win and lose races. That's not where we win and lose races. Absolutely not. This is the 2008 and 2012 Public Service Commission races and the presidential races. If you look at the top, what I want you to see is John McCain had 2,048,000 votes. 2 million, a little bit more than 2 million votes, right? Saxby Chambliss had 1,867,000. There were 181,000 people who went and they voted for John McCain, and then they did not vote for Saxby Chambliss. It wasn't because those two guys aren't similar. They didn't vote at all because both candidates lost.
What about the third party? Where was he? How many did he get?
Let's see, 47, he had got about 3%.
Yeah.
But it was enough, you can see Chambliss got under 50% and ended up in a runoff against Jim Martin. The next race down, the third thing on your ballot is Public Service Commission. How many of y'all have a utility bill every month? I got a utility bill every month. If I add up my monthly utilities, they cost more to me than property taxes on my house. Most of y'all know who your county commissioner is. You know whether he's good or bad, she's good or bad on property taxes. Most of y'all probably don't know who your public service commissioners are or how they affect your rates. Can anyone name a member of the public service commission?
Bubba McDonald. Tim Eccles.
Tim Eccles.
That's two. Bubba McDonald and Tim Eccles. The third one's up there, Chuck Eaton. He's a Republican also. Anyone else? Doug Everett and Stan Wise. Those five people will affect your pocketbook if you're a Georgia Power and AGL ratepayer more than your county commissioner will. But most folks don't pay any attention. And we really see that in the 2008 Public Service Commission race, where Bubba McDonald lost 339,000 votes from what John McCain got. These are Republicans who went out. They voted for John McCain. Most of them voted for Saxby Chambliss. Almost 340,000 didn't vote for anybody. It wasn't the third party that pushed Bubba McDonald and Saxby Chambliss into runoffs. It was Republicans who did not bother to vote for anybody. So fast forward to 2012, I was managing Chuck Eaton's campaign for Public Service Commission. It's a statewide race, and you have just pennies on the dollar compared to a governor's campaign in order to reach the same number of voters. And I went back and I looked at these historical trends, and I figured out that this number right here, that was my enemy. That 340,000 people who didn't vote for anybody, much less the Republican. We were polling about 6 weeks out. We were in the field 3 to 5 nights a week, getting numbers back every night. The only thing I was paying attention to was the difference between Mitt Romney and Chuck Eaton. Not undecided voters. They're too hard to persuade. It shouldn't be too hard to persuade a Republican who's there in the booth to just click one more name. And so we were looking at this. We were confident Romney was going to win, and we were about 4 points behind Romney, consistently. 4 points behind. If we're 4 points behind and Romney comes in like he did at 53%, we're in a runoff in December. We're going to be robocalling the heck out of y'all, ruining your family dinners, and ruining my vacation. So what do you do in that? Do you go after those very few undecided voters? No. You call Republicans. We did not do anything in the last 4 to 6 weeks to communicate with undecided voters, to try to figure out who they are, to affect their votes in any way. We contacted Republican voters that we knew were going to go to the polls. And our message was literally this. After you vote for Mitt Romney, please check the box next to Chuck Eaton on the very next line, because we know that too few people actually bother to vote the whole ticket. And over the course of that 6 weeks, we were able to get the differential between Mitt Romney and ourselves to about 1 point. And that was what saved Christmas for my family. So yeah, there's very few undecided voters. We need to do a better job keeping our own house. And that's not even to discuss the people who are Republicans out there in their heart of hearts and don't show up at all. We've been hearing a lot about polls in the 2016 Republican nomination. This is what it was like in 2012. We had 3 months of Mitt Romney, and then Rick Perry comes on strong. 17 polls in a row, Rick Perry's leading. What happened to him? He went away. Romney's up again for about a month. And then Herman Cain comes on strong. Y'all remember that? 999? He was doing a very good job, and then he went away. Then it was Newt Gingrich. He got to be the flavor of the month for November of 2011, and he went away. Then Romney's up again for a while. Gingrich again. Rick Santorum. He was a real candidate. He came in, he did a fly-in to Peachtree DeKalb Airport. Tons of people showed up. It was exciting because we never get presidential candidates in Georgia. And he just faded away. And Mitt Romney ended up the nominee. That is not to say that that's going to happen this time. But I think there's a chance that the guy who is leading now may not be there in 6 months. It's not a prediction that he won't. It's just saying that dominating the polls for a while is no assurance that you're going to win. This drives me crazy. The Democrats do a great job of promoting this. I just went out on the web and Googled on you know, vote the Democratic ticket or something like that. And you come up with all kinds of examples of this. They push their voters to vote Democrat every single place on the ticket, and we don't do a good job of that. We need to make sure that people understand the importance of every single office on the ballot. I'm going to flip ahead a couple. Who's leading all the polls now?
Trump.
Y'all think he's going to be the nominee?
I hope not.
Raise your hands if you think Trump's going to be the nominee. Raise your hands if you think it'll be somebody else. I think this is a pretty good case that it could very well be somebody else. This is Rudy Giuliani at this time 8 years ago. Every single poll he's leading by 14 points, he's leading by 17 points. He is just absolutely crushing everybody. He's a loud guy from New York who's dominating all the polls. For about a year prior to this, there were 188 polls, he won 169 of them. No other single candidate won more than five. There were a handful of ties, handful went to Huckabee or somebody else. But what happened to President Giuliani? Ma'am? How did he leave? Does anyone remember how he left? What happened was his strategy was he was going to ignore those first four states, Iowa, New Hampshire, Nevada, South Carolina, and he was just going to take all the cookies home in Florida because that was the next really big state. And apparently there's a lot of former New Yorkers in Florida. Has anyone heard about this? And he thought that his record as mayor of New York, and it was fine. He was a great mayor on 9/11 and for the days after that. But he thought that was going to carry the day in Florida. What happened was he got trounced in those first four states, and in March he came in third in Florida. And he was over. He was over because he let all the momentum get away before his big start was going to go. That's what happens when you're not any good at campaigning and when you don't hire people who are any good at campaigning. I don't think that's going to happen to Donald Trump. He's got some really, he's getting some really seasoned campaign advisors. He is actually appears to be building out an organization. But a lot of times, people who haven't run for president before don't do a very good job at it because they haven't run for president before. That's why you had McCain, who had previously run. You had Romney, who had previously run. You sort of get all the mistakes out the first time. I think if something's going to stop Donald Trump from being the nominee of our party, my party, I don't know if y'all are Republicans or not, the nominee of the Republican Party, it's going to be Donald Trump. It might be that he decides it doesn't make financial sense. He could get a little bit further down the road and start thinking about what it looks like to not be in business anymore and just decides that's not any fun. Or he looks at, is there somebody who can take over the management of his empire? There's a dozen reasons he could decide. I think he either decides or he, in some other way, may take himself out. But an early lead in the polls is worth nothing. These are the exit polls from the 2014 race. Michelle Nunn against David Perdue. Can somebody tell me what the gender gap is?
52 women, I believe.
But what does that mean when I say gender gap? How about if I throw out a definition, you tell me if I'm right or not? What most people think the gender gap means is that women tend to vote for Democrats more frequently than they vote for Republicans. Is that what that means? That's what a lot of people would have you believe it means. That is why Michelle Nunn was thought to be a great candidate, because she's a female, and all these women are going to vote for her because she's a female. Didn't really happen that way. She ended up with about 4 points better than David Perdue. That's not much of a gap. That's not the gap that Democrats talk about when they want to talk about the war on women or when they want to talk about unequal pay for the same hours, for that kind of stuff. they're trying to create a gap, but it's not really there in Georgia. But what is the other side of that gender gap? What's the difference among men? 16-point difference among men. If you spend all day campaigning on the idea that women need protection from men, you might lose a few men. And so when they talk about the gender gap, very often you have this same dynamic. For every advantage that Democrats may have in women or may be able to create in women, they're also creating a disadvantage among men. There's fewer of us who vote, but when you have a 16-point difference, that adds up. I want to talk about the cost and scale of polling. When I did a poll for WRBL in Columbus, how much do you think they spent on that? Throw out a number.
$25,000.
Anyone else?
$100?
$45,000. Anyone else? $1,000. I did it basically at a break-even rate. When WSB did, a friend of mine does the polls for WSB, he charged them $1,000. You can get good work for $1,000. David Perdue spent $42,000 in 1 month. You think his polls were the same as the ones that the media were showing us? Not even close. When I talked to David Perdue's primary strategist, he said, they were polling three nights a week, every night, for weeks in advance of the election. They could see trends happening over the course of a couple nights, whereas somebody like the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, who was polling maybe every 6 weeks, maybe every 4 weeks, they would see something happen and think it was a big switch, whereas Purdue had been seeing it happen over time. And they just have much better information. The National Republican Senatorial Committee was polling extensively. The Georgia Republican Party was polling extensively. There were probably a couple super PACs polling. I wouldn't be surprised if they were spending $200,000 a month, $300,000 a month just on the Republican side in the last 2 months. And so it is a difference. It's the difference between a $1,000 car and a $42,000 car or a $250,000 car. It is a completely different thing. I went to see Donald Trump on Saturday, and you can see that looks like an enthusiastic crowd. Were any of y'all at that Trump event? Two? How would you describe it? How does it compare to other political events you've been to?
It was bigger.
You were at that? What did you think of it?
I was really surprised at the diversity of the crowd. I really was. I didn't know what to expect, but the age group, and I saw lots of Hispanics, lots of Black, lots of Asian, and I liked that. That's something I didn't.
And more than anything else, I saw a ton of people. When I arrived 2 hours before it started, and the line came out the door, went along the side of the parking lot, and then along this other side of the parking lot. It's the longest line I've ever seen at a political event. More people there than at a Georgia Republican convention. I'm hard-pressed to think of a political event I've seen that had more people in the state of Georgia. And they were just going nuts. What was interesting to me was not just the signs and all that stuff, but see how many cell phones there are? I mean, look, this is an iPad, I think. Cell phone, cell phone, cell phone, cell phone, all over there. People were, that's the way they interact with politics, is through their screen. And this was an event for them. It was great. It was great.
How many were there?
8,000.
I'll tell you what I think. There were 4,400 tickets available on their Eventbrite website. Those were sold out. So I think the minimum number that was there is probably 4,000 to 5,000. The place held, it's permitted to hold 7,500, and it was pretty full. I couldn't count them. If you told me anything between 4,500 and 7,500 or 8,000, I'd believe it. Just because I can't, I'm not good at estimating. I never won those things where you have the jelly beans in a jar and you're supposed to count the number. But even at the low end, that's a huge event. And people showed up. I got there at 10 o'clock and there were probably close to 1,000 people in there already, 2 hours before it was supposed to start on a Saturday, when people have better stuff to do or other stuff to do. It was fantastic from that respect. I don't know if he's going to be our nominee, but here's what I would like to see as a Republican. I would like to see him drawing crowds like this 3 times a day in all the swing states. I want to see him doing this in Florida, in Ohio, in Texas, in North Carolina. Whether he's our nominee or not, if he can get this many people excited enough to get up and drive somewhere on a Saturday, he can help us get them excited enough to drive somewhere on a Tuesday and vote. And I guarantee you, of that 4,000 to 8,000 people, there were at least hundreds of people there who don't vote normally. And if we can get those people and get them to understand the importance of voting, that would be a great service to both the Republican Party and to the country.
Have you done any polling specifically yet as to why people are so enthused about Trump?
No, but I will tell you what I believe. I believe it's the same way with Giuliani. I think he is the most recognizable name. I think they've heard some stuff they like about him. And at this point in the election, a year off, that's enough to choose from his name and 16 names you've never heard of before, or some that sound vaguely familiar, but nobody out there knows who any of the other candidates are for the most part, outside of their home states. They recognize Jeb Bush's name, they maybe recognize 3 or 4 other names. I think a lot of it's that name ID, and that he hasn't said anything they disagree with yet that they know of. It's like Giuliani. Why was Giuliani dominating for a year and a half? It was because he was the most recognizable person. Everybody in this room can think about 9/11, and one of your memories from that day is Rudy Giuliani. But that's not enough. You also have to do the shovel and pick work of building an organization in at least 30 states, and Giuliani didn't do that. Trump is doing that, but right now I think it's a lot name ID and celebrity. That's just my guess. Herman Cain came out and talked. I'm not sure I'd be taking advice from him on how to run a presidential campaign. He said he's got 6 candidates he's rooting for. And I'm kind of like that. I've got about 16 candidates I'm rooting for. If you read my newsletter when Ted Cruz spent all that time in Georgia, you would have thought I loved Ted Cruz. I'm just excited that we're getting to see presidential candidates. Normal people who don't give $2,000 checks are able to go out and meet 3 or 4 Republican presidential candidates, and that's a great thing for us. And so when Trump's in town, I'm going to be enthusiastic about Trump for several days because it was a neat event. And when Rubio comes to town, I'm enthusiastic about him because I want them all to feel welcome in Georgia. I want them all to know that we're important to their election.
Did you have any interaction with Carson when he was in Gainesville?
No, I didn't. I tried to get in touch with his campaign, and they weren't terribly helpful. And I kind of feel a little bit petty saying this. They weren't very helpful, so I didn't feel like I needed to go. I do this for fun. I do this to entertain myself and other people. And so I'd been on the road for 3 or 4 days. I just went home and had dinner with my wife. I hope to see him when he's here. I've seen him a couple times in the past. It's just, I don't think his campaign was doing a very good job of welcoming the people who want to help him spread the word. My thing is, I don't ask presidential candidates gotcha questions. I say, what do you want the voters of Georgia to know about you? That's the best way I think you can be of a service to the voters right now is help them find out what makes these people, what do they believe, what do they want to do, why should we vote for them? Y'all may know this guy, I'm not sure I've heard him. It's interesting, he's a first-term senator. Not somebody most people would consider a big mover and shaker yet at the state capitol. He's not a chairman of a committee. And he was the first guy to endorse Trump. There was another fella named Burt Jones, who I believe he's in his first term as well. He was the second person to endorse Donald Trump. And that illustrates to me, I don't think it's that Trump is not popular with elected officials. I think that he hasn't spent any time at all asking them for their support. He's running his campaign in a different way. Jeb Bush spent the last 6-9 months asking elected officials for their support because that's how everybody does it. Rubio did that, Walker did that. I think Trump just doesn't think that's as important as talking to the voters. And so he's doing everything in a different way. This is my last slide. This is the t-shirts they were giving out. And I grabbed one of them. I think souvenirs of political campaigns, I'm kind of a nerd that way, and I take them. And I thought this was interesting. They're printed on American Apparel t-shirts. All the kids love these t-shirts. They cost about, if you're buying printed t-shirts to give out or to sell out, they cost about 3 times as much. Cost about $7 a piece versus $2 or $3 for just a cheap import. Before I saw that tag, I said, I'm going to grab one of these shirts. I want to know if the guy who's writing Make America Great Again is printing his t-shirts on a cheap Chinese import. That's decimated the South. North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, we used to have textile factories. Monroe, Georgia used to have these huge textile factories. We don't have them anymore. And he was using a very expensive American-made t-shirt. I got to give him credit for that. Most campaigns wouldn't even have thought of it, but if you're printing Make America Great Again, you got to spend the extra money to put it on an American shirt. And it's most likely his own money. I think that's pretty cool. I think that of 1,000 people they gave this t-shirt to, maybe 2 or 3 of them would have noticed that, but I think we ought to say that's a great thing. If you ever run for office, when you're spending money, you got to buy 25 or 50 shirts to get them printed. The difference between $3 and $7 is a lot of money. When you're getting signs, I like to get my signs from a printer in Georgia. There are some printers in Florida that are a little bit less expensive, even with shipping. I like to do it in Georgia. It costs more, but it's a hard decision to make. Some candidates have enough money or it's important enough to them. And if we're buying printed in Georgia signs, I put printed in Georgia. I don't know where the plastic bit was made, so I can't say it was made in Georgia. But I know the work was done here. And I hope that becomes increasingly important to voters. That's all I have for tonight. Does anyone have any questions, comments?
Yeah, there's a thought process out in the public. Pollsters only poll a certain way because they want to get a certain answer. Is that true?
You can do that, but it depends on who you're polling for. Are you polling for the media or are you polling for candidates? Candidates don't care so much about, well, good candidates. The first time you buy polling in, you want the answers to come out your way. But as you get experience in politics, you want the truth, because that's how you win. But the role of a pollster in a campaign is not just telling you this is what the voters are doing today, it's helping you to figure out how to get to where you want to be. And so the real value of a pollster is not just being able to get the numbers right, but in helping you get to 51%. And so a pollster could be dead wrong, inaccurate on the numbers, but if he helps my candidate win every single time, he's a good pollster in my book. For the media pollsters, I don't think that they You don't necessarily ask questions to skew the results, but a couple things happen. If you are not from Georgia, you probably ask the question wrong. If you're not from Georgia, you ask the two-party candidates. And what you should be doing is three of them, because there will be a Libertarian on the ballot at the top of the ticket. We've seen runoffs because of the Libertarians, and you have to have the question right. That is a result of pollsters who are not from Georgia and either don't have the time or don't care enough to find out how we vote. I think that when you ask the question, who would you vote for, it should be as close to the way it's going to be on the ballot. It should be in the order it's going to be. If it says incumbent on the ballot, you should note that in the question. If it has parties, you should say that. If it doesn't have parties, you don't say that. But they may just not care. You know, you're polling in 50 states. You can't have 50 different polls. You want one poll that you go everywhere. And so that's part of it. The other part of it is it's not necessarily the questions you ask or the results you get. It's how you describe what that means. So if my poll shows something different from what somebody else's poll showed that last week, and they ask me, well, what does that mean? I'm gonna say, it's an exciting race, and voters are changing their minds, and this guy did something really stupid, and this guy did something really great, and it's a great horse race. Real answer, one of us is wrong. But that doesn't make good television. And so sometimes when you're being paid to entertain people, you entertain them. Doesn't hurt. Y'all shouldn't believe the polls, by the way. Do y'all watch football? Anyone here watch football?
Yes.
What happens every single football game? They have people calling in, and you got somebody saying, here's what needs to happen. Georgia needs to score more points than the other team. Their defense needs to hold them, and their offense needs to put points on the board. I think Mark Rick knows that. It's how you get there. If you've ever seen, have any of y'all ever seen a football playbook? It's hundreds or thousands of pages long. Now they put them on iPads so that they don't have to print 1,000 pages for every player. So you might have 1,000 plays. You're going into a game against one opponent, and you narrow it down. You say, these are the 120 plays we're likely to play. And then the coach has his first 10 plays he's going to do. It's not just offense got to do some points. Defense got to hold them. It's we're going to do this, and this guy is going to go here at this point on the third play. That's the difference between pollsters on television saying what is happening in the race and campaign managers and consultants back at home planning how to win. It's the difference between somebody calling in and saying, we got to do good or we're going to lose. And the coach out there coming up with a plan up to midnight every night to actually make that happen. You had a question, sir?
Yes. There's a lot of talk on the news about three outside candidates in the top four or five in the polls, fairly consistently. Do you think that's really unprecedented, or do you think that matters, or is it just noise?
Okay, so David Perdue was the outside candidate, right? That was what he ran as. He was a Fortune 500 company of multiple Fortune 500 companies. He was some kind of an insider. He was not a political insider, but he was some kind of an insider, right? It's just a different club. Carly Fiorina was a Fortune 500 CEO. She's raised a few million dollars, so she knows people who will give her checks of $2,000 enough to get her to 2,000. That's not an outsider. It's a non-politician. Oh, she's also run for office before, spent $10 million on it. So.
But she's also worked for McCain before.
Yeah.
She's got some political know-how.
And Trump, he is not a politician before now, but he's given millions of dollars. He's been deeply involved in politics at all different levels. He's not that much of an outsider.
Yeah.
You're against everybody.
And in Key, in not Key West, Palm Beach, Florida, he's a member of every club. He is an insider there. He's an insider in New York City. Probably can tell you where the best place to have lunch with a couple senators in Washington, D.C. is. So it's a marketing position that they are outsiders. There's something to it that they're not part of that same mindset, but outsiders don't tend to get elected president of the United States. They don't tend to get elected to the United States Senate, but every now and then they do a good enough job, and it does. I think that there is a difference between answering a poll question on your telephone, on your couch at home, in October of 2015, and pressing the button on who's going to have the red phone next to their bed and the nuclear codes on a Marine outside his bedroom door. And you know, when you get to voting, some of that reality comes in. But I think in many ways, it's just a way for people who are not that knowledgeable about politics to pretend they're knowledgeable about politics, meaning the analysts on television. It's something that they can hang their hat on, and when they hear three other analysts on different networks doing it, they can be confident that they're not going to embarrass themselves. That's how things become memes, right? Mm-hmm. You hear three other people say it, and you say, well, if I say it's about outsiders and the public is angry, well, nobody's going to say I'm stupid. A lot of them are very intelligent people, but not necessarily experts on politics. The other thing you hear a lot is that the electorate is angry. That's been true of every electorate for the past 20 years. I went and I looked this up. And Pew Research is one of the companies that has been consistently polling for 50 years, asking a lot of the same questions. And if you go look at Pew Research questions leading up to the last three or four elections, a lot of voters angry. Yeah, I'm angry. I had to sit in traffic out here. I'm angry my bank wants me to pay my bills every month. I'm angry because of all sorts of reasons. So when somebody calls me up and says, are you angry about politics? Yeah, I am. But that doesn't mean it's different from before. In 2014, people were angry. 2012, people were angry. On and on and on. But just because somebody with a microphone says it doesn't mean it's true. Unless it's me. I'm pretty good at this stuff. Yes, sir?
Do you think that a lot of it right now is that there are so many people who are angry that they are not willing to vote for an insider?
Mm-hmm. I think that's part of it, but I also think that people, when they're angry, have one reaction, and then later when they cool off, they do something different. My marriage got a lot better when I realized that my first instinct is always wrong. And when I get mad, shut up. Because 6 hours later, I'm gonna feel differently. And again, I think there's a difference between thinking about what a world might be like with a president who's willing to go fly around the world and just tell everybody, hey, hell with you. It's fun to think about that kind of stuff. Like, it's fun to think about winning the lottery. I can tell you how I spend my money when I win the lottery. I don't even play it. But it's one of those things you kind of daydream about. But when it comes down to hard, cold reality, I'm not going to count on the lottery to pay for my retirement. I'm going to do the things that I don't necessarily want to do that aren't as fun, and probably suck it up and do some unfun stuff. I think that what you're getting right now is the answers that people give is something they haven't really thought about. They're just answering based on the first thing that pops into their mind. Whereas when you get to November of next year, a lot of people will have been thinking about it for 2 or 3 weeks, who they're going to vote for. Some people will have been thinking about it for 6 months, and they'll come to a decision that they think is responsible and reasonable and tends to be the more boring decision. But I could be wrong. You can have me back in a year when we're crowning President Trump and just make fun of me for being wrong, if that happens.
The beaver situation is influencing the way people are thinking right now.
I think most people get up in the morning and they go to work and they do everything they have to do in their life and with their family, and the name John Boehner never pops into their head once.
So it's only us idiots in the room that...
But for me, the name of the quarterback of the University of Georgia never pops into my mind because I just, that's not what I follow. I follow politics. A lot of people talk about whether Mark Richt ought or ought not to be fired, the way we talk about why Boehner ought or ought not to be fired. But that's a small group. More people have an opinion in the state of Georgia on whether Mark Richt ought to be fired and when he ought to be fired than have an opinion about John Boehner one way or the other. I'll go this far. There are more people in the state of Georgia who have an opinion about whether or not Mark Richt ought to be fired than could correctly pronounce John Boehner's name if it were held up on a piece of paper in front of them. That's just something that people talk about that care about politics, and the talking heads whose job it is to pretend they understand what's going on. Sir?
In your polling, I'm sure you, it sounds like you do most of your polling with candidates. And my question to you is, from what you see out there, if you had to put the top two issues voters are concerned with, what two issues would you say would be at the top?
I've been in professional politics for 20 years. And for most of that 20 years, you could say crime, education, and taxes. And you would be right. In, I want to say 2004, there was a special election, and the candidate came to me and said, they're not interested in crime, education, and taxes. They're all asking me questions about illegal immigration. That's now up there. That's it. Same as it's ever been. There's not a whole lot of change. I didn't believe him. For 6 months, I didn't believe him that was an issue. And it has been become one of the great issues of our day. People don't change much. Crime, education, and taxes. That's it. So what did we do in the last session of the General Assembly? We did criminal justice reform. We did education reform, and we did tax reform. That's it. That's the big stuff we did. So and by tax reform, I mean tax raising. Don't tell anyone I said that.
Gun control falls under crime?
It falls under crimes against citizens by the government. And I gotta say, y'all are the best armed group I've ever spoken to. In a gunfight between y'all and the Gwinnett County Republican Party, y'all got them dead to rights every single time. I think that gun control is... It is not something that I think most people go to bed thinking about and wake up thinking about in the morning, unless they're one of the people for whom guns are either a hobby or the boogeyman that keeps them awake late at night, something that, that stresses them out, walking around thinking, who here has a gun? I don't think that's 20% of the population. I don't think that's 30% of the population. I think it's single digits on each side. It's something that politicians are using to get us to behave in one way or the other. They're telling you Obama wants your guns, and Obama's telling his people that he wants your guns. But they're doing that to try to make things happen in Washington or at the state capitol, not because 1,000 people called them yesterday and said, you got to do something about gun control. Either make sure it never happens or make sure it happens tomorrow.
What's the biggest surprise you've ever had with your polling?
Okay, so in 2002, I worked for a consulting firm. We did a lot of polling, and we had a candidate who had more money than maybe he had since. And he asked us to do a poll in October of the governor's race. And I said, We don't have to do a poll. You just look at the newspapers. They all say that Roy Barnes is going to whip Sonny Perdue. All of them. So Roy, I'll save you $20,000. Roy Barnes is going to whip Sonny Perdue. He wanted to spend the money anyway, so we did the poll, and the sample came back and it showed Sonny Perdue winning. So I went to my boss, the president of the company, and I said, the poll says something that everybody else thinks is wrong. It must be wrong. I didn't have the confidence in the process at that point in my career. And I talked him into, you know, we can't give this to our candidate, to our client, and be embarrassed by it in 3 weeks or 6 weeks or whatever it was, and have him thinking we're lousy at this. We got to go do it again. So we spent our own money. I spent the firm's own money to redo that sample. And it came back a second time saying that Sonny Perdue was going to be Roy Barnes. And I just couldn't believe it. So we took it to the client, said, this is what it says. I'm not sure what we did wrong. We did it twice. And then election day comes up, and what happens? I was every bit as surprised as everybody else. My regret is that I didn't just jump on it and wave it around and email it to every news media out there, because they would have run it. Because this is a groundbreaking poll. It says these pollsters are idiots. And we would have laughed all the way home after that. And that was a lesson to me, to trust the process of doing the poll the way I know to do it. Make sure if I have questions about the results, go back and look at my process. Because if the process that has done well, that I've done well by for 20 years, if I've done everything right, poll's probably pretty accurate. And if I am not accepting that, I'm putting my faith in somebody else. So that's the biggest surprise I've ever had. And I was surprised that Purdue beat Jack Kingston. I went out to all these events and I thought the grassroots was going to carry it. Nope, the sofa roots carried it. The folks who didn't come out to Republican Party events, to Tea Party events, they changed it. Yes, sir?
We have an election in November, and one of the big things is the East Bloc. I asked my county commissioner, they say it was put there because it was a very complicated issue and they didn't want to get confused when it's on the ballot with other issues. I have other reasons why I think they put it as a special one in November. Have you seen any polling at all? How much are they going to win that by? The difficulty is, of course, all the teachers and administrators are in the polling station. They don't even have to leave work to vote.
There is a technical term in polling called horseshit. And somebody tried to sell you a bunch of it. They did it because they think they can affect the election results. In DeKalb County, they set a new one penny sale tax for March of next year because they think they can control it, and it's going to get shot down because of the mess that DeKalb County, the undeniable mess that DeKalb County is. Nobody trusts, I wouldn't trust any of those folks with my car keys, with my wallet, with your wallet. I wouldn't even trust them with your wallet. It is an attempt to gain a favorable electorate. It's the rules say you can do it.
I mean, you think it's going to be a landslide win?
I don't know. I haven't looked at your local one yet, but I will tell you this, that politicians are no better at predicting election results than the average person walking down the street is at predicting the Super Bowl winner. Politicians, you know, they put the T-splost when they thought it was sure to pass. When they thought they'd have plenty of Democrats out the ballot who would help them pass it. And it went down in resounding defeat. So let the politicians play their politicians' games and go out and find as many voters as you can to oppose what they're doing if you oppose it. Because here's the downside of their strategy. If they're doing it at a time when there's going to be fewer voters, it means if you want to beat it, you have to convince fewer voters to go to the poll and vote against it. And so politicians aren't always great at politics. Sir, you had a question?
I wanted to ask you about who it is you're sampling. A campaign is going to sample, their sample people might be different than a than one that's a poll from a newspaper,
sure.
Right? And given the idea that, you know, the largest political party out there is the apathetic party, how does all that play with respect to what you do?
One thing I've learned about people is that they are by and large creatures of habit. They tend to do the same thing the same time every day, every week, every month. And a corollary of that is at any given election, and I've done the research on this, and this is the percentage. 80% of the people who show up for an election are the same people that showed up at the last election like that. So if it's a city election in November of an odd numbered year, 80% of the people who show up on November 3rd of this year are going to be the people who showed up in 11 or 13 in November. And so for me,
that's going to be your sample.
That is who I'm going to sample. I generally sample the people who voted in the last election like this one. Now, there are times when that doesn't work. I'm working in the city of Brookhaven mayor's race. We've never had a mayor's race before. We did, but it was in 2012 when they passed the incorporation. And so that was a presidential election year. There were a whole lot more voters than are going to show up in November 2015. So you kind of estimate who you're going to go out for. But here's my second rule. Here's my second rule of thumb. When in doubt, poll more people. There is a rule of statistics called the rule of large numbers that generally speaking, what it says is the bigger the sample, the more reliable it is. And here's what I have learned through robo-polling. That's what I do. 95% of my polls are robo-polls. They can be inaccurate, they can be accurate. If you've done 200 of them, you know what you're doing and you can do a pretty good job of it. If you see me talking publicly about a statewide poll, my sample size is going to be 1,500 or more.
Out of all those people that you call, how many just hang up?
99%.
To
get a 1,500 sample, I'm probably dialing 100,000 phone numbers. The minimum, with a robo-poll, the minimum number of phone numbers you need to dial to get a 300 sample is probably 10,000 phone numbers, which means that a state house is about the smallest election you can get a good sample using a robo-poll. There are other ways to compensate for that. You can just pound on people, call them three nights in a row until they answer. Because people
That's
will eventually.
The clock works.
Yeah, but there's a lot of folks who aren't that sophisticated.
Maybe one more question.
And so my thing is, there is a point at which numerically, if you ask enough people, it doesn't matter who you ask. But I tend to ask people who voted in the last similar election. One last question, did you say?
Maybe.
Yes, sir.
I would say there are insiders and there are insiders, distinguished by kind of the Washington power elite and their consultants and their donors. Could you comment on how that may influence things?
What I would say that there are several inside groups. People who get invited to join Augusta National Golf Club tend not to be politicians, but they're very much a type of insider and elite. And I would guess that 9 out of 10 Washington insiders would rather be the kind of insider that gets to go play golf at Augusta. There is an ambition there. There are people who would like to pull the levers and make us dance like puppets. The problem is they're not terribly good at it. And we're not very cooperative with them. And they can help us, they can maybe narrow the number of choices we have. They can maybe steer us in a direction, but it's hard to direct elections, it's hard to direct legislation, because one of the features of our democracy, and I think of it as a feature, not a bug, is that it is hard to get things done. It is hard for people to get things done, and it is hard for insiders to get things done. When people want to wail about how Washington's not getting anything done, I'm okay with that. I would be okay if we limited our state legislature to 10 bills a year.
Yeah.
I would certainly be happy if we enacted a regulation that said for every bill you pass, you got to repeal some part of the code. And so as somebody who grew up in a different kind of Republican Party than we have today. We were more of a country club, more libertarian style. I think that the government not being able to do stuff is great. And I think that what makes it hard for politicians to accomplish things, to get things done, what makes it hard for us as individuals to get things done with government, also makes it hard for the elites to get things done. Because there is no elite out there whose plan had John Boehner walking off stage, leaving no leadership at all. You know, so they're there, they're trying to do stuff. They're not any better at it than I am at throwing the football. Thank you very much. Thank you.
That's about it. Do we have any the legislation thing? I thought we ought to have right now somebody do a word count on the Georgia code, and that's the limit. So if you add 16 words, you got to take out 16 words. And maybe we could put a reduction of 5% every year, actually, on top of that. Anybody have any announcements or anything they need to say or talk about?
The only thing is, just for those of you who normally come, we welcome all of you. There will be no meeting in December. Last year we tried to have a reception and it fell flat. So this year we've said we'll just let everyone enjoy their church life and their family life. And we'll see you in January right back here. But we'll see you in November.
December's tough. We're also not having a December meeting in Lawrenceville. No. Yeah, Lawrenceville. We're not having a January meeting in Swanee. So I'm gonna keep all this straight. I'll be up here for a while if you want to ask me any questions. Todd's got to clean up, so he'll be here for at least a minute. Nydia's over there. She's got these books. Please come grab one. She brings them to every meeting. Like I said, it's something to read. I know you guys read a lot. Thank you for coming, and we'll see you next month. We do have a meeting.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks for listening to me. It makes me feel good about myself when nobody falls asleep that I can see. I don't think Trump's going to split the party. I think my best guess is that Trump may exit on his own terms. I think he may decide that being president of the world is not as fun as being not. I think Donald Trump is probably a lot more fun than the world. But what I will say is this: I don't want anybody to push him out. If he decides to get out, I hope it's on his own terms, even if he has something he'd rather do. But the energy at the rally he got, I do want him to feel. If he gets out, I want him to feel like his plan he did it, that he made a difference, and that I want him to believe he was treated fairly by the voters. Because I want him out there having those big rallies whenever he can to turn out votes. The voters who are willing to take advice from him, and he tells them the most important thing you can do is go out and vote for Republicans. I want that energy. I want those brains that we didn't have. Whatever is missing from our party that he brings, I want to fix it. That's even better than being in there at the beginning of the Boston morning. I can't carry it in the church unless the church is there. I guess you can carry it.
Thanks for being here.
My pleasure.
We appreciate you coming out. Sharing the knowledge.
Almost everywhere else I go.
That's really hard.
It's not. And that's one thing about the dogs. I think dogs can be a gateway to politics for some people. I had somebody come up when I was at a Georgia Tea Party meeting as a group in Marietta. They have like meetings 3 nights a week or something. Great group. Somebody came up and said they got involved because they started getting my newsletter because of the dogs, but they saw how their county was not dealing with the shelter where they were. And they started going to county commission meetings to discuss it. And that led to them eventually getting involved in the Tea Party group. I'm glad to know that because hopefully we'll get some more dog lovers involved and clean up some issues that we don't do very well.
So they feed each other.
But if you know what somebody cares about, you know how to get them involved. Come on.
Sure, can you have those things?